Thank you. It's an honor to be able to be back. 2 years ago, I was here and spoke about cochlear implants, and that was a lot of fun. I was impressed with your crowd, so I am thrilled to be able to be back and speak to you again. I'm going to tell you a story about a complicated patient I took care of and how we used pig intestine to fix her trachea. However, there's a little bit more that goes into understanding what was wrong and what we did. And in order to do that, we're going to have to understand a lot about the trachea and the importance of the trachea in things like fixing the trachea. So we'll go through some of the basics of the airway anatomy, because as simple as it is, it can create a lot of confusion and make it very hard for people to understand why it's such a fragile environment. And then I want you to make sure you understand the importance of the airway to oxygenation and ventilation, and then how the operating room works so that you can understand what it took to fix this little baby. And then we'll talk about her and her very special anatomy and the problems that her special anatomy caused, not just for her, but for trying to fix her. And how, what solution we came up with in order to fix it, and then how she's doing now. So GT and I were talking earlier, back when I was in college. I have to think back to college to put myself in the right frame of mind. I'm used to lecturing medical students a lot, and they've already been through a lot of science in order to get there. But thinking back to where I was in college, there's what one thinks they want in life, and there's what one plans to do and achieve in life, and then there's the path that life offers you. And so, as I said in physics class, never had I expected that I would be here telling this story today. Before I can tell you how we used pig intestine to repair the airway of this little baby, whose chance of death in the first year of life was 95% or more. And even with treatment, the best treatment that we had available, she still had a 90% chance of very, very significant comorbidity from it, which means a really unfavorable outcome. The worst of which, of course, would be the living equivalent of death. I'd love to get straight into the story, because it's something that is easy to be passionate about. But before I can tell you that story, as Captain Underpants books always go, and I've read all 11 of these with my son more than once, before I can tell you that story, I have to tell you this story. So that's the story of the basics of the airway anatomy, oxygenation, ventilation, and the operating room. So this is the simple process. We breathe oxygen in, and then we breathe carbon dioxide out, right? Very, very simple. And we start with the nose and the mouth, where it comes in, and it goes down the trachea into the main stem bronchi, goes out to the lungs, and there it will be exposed to blood flow coming out of the heart that needs to have oxygen put into it. And although you sit here listening to the beginning of this story, breathing really comfortably, and not even having to think about what it takes to be breathing, the simple airways are very complex in their development embryologically, and then on to formation throughout pregnancy and into what becomes the adult human. So you all recall hearing that the human embryo has gills, just like a fish. Well, this is that principle called autogeny recapitulates phylogeny, and our process of development as an embryo goes through these stages. The cell groups communicate molecularly, and that process of intercellular signaling is what helps the tissues differentiate or turn into the tissues that they should be. During the early stages of development, the gills, which are in the central area of the embryo, they form what's called the mesoderm and the endoderm, and the endoderm becomes the tube that is the airway. And then this develops into a stalk that forms the trachea and the esophagus. And therefore, both the breathing and the food passages are going to share that same space from the time they develop for the rest of your life. They're supposed to have a wall between the two of them. So here we go. There's that little embryo up there, and it's doing its gill thing, the branchial arches and the pharyngeal pouches. And here is where we have our stalk form right there. And there's supposed to be a separation between that trachea and the esophagus. Pretty important thing to have. And when that separation forms, then we get our trachea in the front and our esophagus in the back. So all the air that travels through the passages of the tracheobronchial tree then goes out into the distal air sacs, called the alveoli, and that's where the gas exchange happens. So this is a little baby with their lungs and these teeny tiny distal airways, as we call them. We like to use the fancy words for all that, as far out as possible. And so those little guys collapse when they don't have air in them, and they fill up when you take a nice deep breath, and these processes are where gas exchange ends up happening. And so your venous blood will come in. It's actually coming from the pulmonary artery, but it's venous blood. And so the venous blood comes in, and it is deoxygenated blood with a lot of carbon dioxide in it, carried on the hemoglobin molecules, and the hemoglobin molecules dump the carbon dioxide, pick up the oxygen, and then give you your oxygenated blood, which is going to flow around through your body, and carry that blood throughout the system so that you can keep all of your tissues happy. So the delivery of that oxygen and the removal of the carbon dioxide are really, really, really critical to your homeostasis, which is that balance keeps your blood acid base in check. And that's what keeps your proteins functioning. You know, when you fry an egg, it never goes back to being the same again. This is the proteins change with the application of heat. There are proteins that change conformation entirely once the pH changes. So these things are really, really important because they affect the capacity for metabolism to continue and the survival of cells, and hence even the survival of the tissues. So as I mentioned, our trachea is in front and our esophagus is in back. And I think that much like birds not having an anal sphincter to keep the poo in while they're flying through the air, one of those cruel jokes that evolution has played, having to take your food and drink and get it over the top of the opening where you breathe your air is probably one of those other cruel jokes as well. Because the chances that you can drop it in here are pretty good, and then you have that horrible coughing fit that happens while you're trying to like tell a story and laugh at the same time. And then it just feels miserable. When that happens, your vocal cords close. They're trying to keep fluid out. This little trap door, the epiglottis, is supposed to fall over and try to help keep stuff from falling in there. But it's really, really hard for a lot of people to understand that the nose and the mouth connect here. Right there, nose and mouth, that airway is common, and that this is common space down here too. And that actually there's a little sphincter right there, a tight muscle that has to relax to allow your food to go down your esophagus and let gravity and muscular contraction take it the rest of the way down. So air with oxygen goes in, and then waste, like carbon dioxide gas, goes out the front tube and the food and drink, and then spit, which also becomes important when you can't control your spit. Spit goes down in the back. So how does this apply to the operating room? Well, this is a lot more complicated than the last diagram I showed you. But this is life in the operating room. So this is a patient who has a breathing tube in, and tubes run over to the machine that ventilates for them. And when it ventilates, it gets the carbon dioxide out. So the number of breaths help move the carbon dioxide out. And it provides oxygen. It oxygenates them as well. So it gives them the supplement of oxygen that they need, as well as anesthetic gases. So here's our breathing tube going over the tongue and into the trachea, which is in front. This one has a little cuff drawn on it, which helps keep some of the fluid out, like pooling spit, while you're sleeping. But in order for us to have anesthesia effectively for general surgery procedures where you're totally asleep and you can't see, hear, feel anything, and you are not in control of your airway, we use a breathing tube to control that airway. And the breathing tube has to have somewhere to go in order to push oxygen as well as anesthesia gases down into the lungs for them to be picked up. All right. So the anesthesia gases, we call them gases, although some people don't like the term gas. Our older attendings didn't really like the term gas. They felt like a little too World War II when they heard gas. So they like to stick with volatile anesthetics. They are primarily, we use what we call SIVO, and I put the little molecular structure for SIVO over there for you. And they're ethers, ether being the first anesthetic gas, first used at a dentist's parties at his house, and then applied to surgical purposes. We also supplement the volatile anesthetic gases that you get through an anesthesia machine. We supplement them with things like propofol or etomidates, things that you can get by the IV. And then we add into that medication for pain management, usually narcotics like morphine. All right, so now that you have some of the background, I'll tell you about the special baby. So our little baby is Maddie. This is Maddie. She used to come to the operating room to see me with messages written all over. She had messages like on every IV site. It was almost like a little hunting game to see where what she had hidden for me. And Maddie was suspected prenatally to have a problem with her airway and her GI tract. She had her mother had a condition called polyhydramnios, which means that there's too much fluid in the amniotic sac. And we see polyhydramnios happen when there is a problem with the airways and the esophagus, because the lungs, the alveoli, actually make the amniotic fluid, and it's supposed to be breathed out and then swallowed back down and then peed out through the kidneys. So the fluid balance that happens in there is pretty delicate. In some conditions, they don't make enough fluid. Others, they make too much. And if you are pregnant and you have a 8-pound baby, but you have 16 pounds of fluid, then you're getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and the uterus can't hold all of that. So you either get a premature delivery or you could actually rupture the uterus. So it becomes a very concerning condition when it happens. Not to mention that we always are suspecting there's something wrong with the development of the lungs or the airway. So the most common cause for the polyhydramnios would be what's called a tracheoesophageal fistula, where there's a connection between the trachea and the esophagus that's not supposed to be there. And so this fluid problem starts. So her family had gone through a lot of counseling about a tracheoesophageal fistula. Most of the time when they happen, the surgeons will go in within a couple days of birth, and they'll open the neck, and they will connect the esophagus up. And then if there's a connection to where it's attached to the trachea, they'll take that attachment off the trachea. And it's a big surgery for a tiny baby, but it's still somewhat straightforward, being all done pretty simply through a very routine type of approach in the neck. So that's what they suspected that she had. And when she was born, she had a little bit of trouble breathing at first, but nothing particularly bad. And they decided to do a swallow study to see whether there was an esophagus that went all the way down or whether the esophagus was separated in two separate pieces, because they see that a lot. So they put a feeding tube down and through the mouth into the stomach, so it passed the whole way down. And then they put some contrast material. They put a barium-laden substance in there. And then they draw the tube out, dropping the barium from the stomach all the way up. And then they get a picture of what the esophagus would look like. So they put 5 milliliters in there. So that's a sixth of an ounce. It's a pretty small volume. They put in into her stomach and went to pull the tube out. And before they'd even moved the tube out themselves, she had refluxed that stuff up high enough that she had got her lungs filled with the barium. So this is not something we see much anymore. We used to have people breathe barium in order to be able to see their airways. But now that we have the CT scanners, we don't have to do any of that. But she has a barium contrast bronchogram, and you can even see her little teeny tiny distal airway areas out there. And so this showed that certainly there was a connection, because down here is where her stomach has got the barium in it. And you can see the whole stomach outline there. And then this is her esophagus up here, right up there, like a big giant tube there. And then her trachea And this is her right main stem bronchus right there. And this is her left main stem here. This is very abnormal. The team decided to take her to the operating room as they had planned. And when they got, so these are the different types of fistula connections, sorry. So those are the different ways the esophagus can be disrupted and there can be a connection to the trachea. So that's what they felt comfortable she had, and they made all their plans. They went to the operating room and they went to take a look at her airway because this was the plan. They thought they'd identified the problem and that they were going to fix it. So we got into the operating room and found something different altogether. Instead of being that she had esophageal disruption, she actually had a complete failure to separate her trachea from her esophagus. And so that's, they're very, very rare, especially the ones that go all the way down to the carina. These we think are sort of like unicorns. Everyone talks about them, but no one's seen them, not really. And then sometimes we'll see these, occasionally those, but rarely these guys. This is just a different kind of view. This is voice box here, but this is looking at it from the front. So there's trachea over there. And then this one diagrams the disruption involving the bronchi on the sides there. And then there's your esophageal tube there. So this is what it looked like. This is her left main stem bronchus and her right main stem bronchus. This is what should be her trachea here, the back wall of her trachea. This is the front wall of her trachea. And then this is a feeding tube actually running all the way down and then going down into her esophagus down there. So that's not what a trachea should look like. That is what a trachea should look like. So it has a beautiful D shape in the cartilage ring here and a soft back wall where that where there's been separation between the esophagus and the trachea, and then left main stem bronchus there and a right main stem bronchus there. So this is a bad problem. Can we all imagine why this is a bad problem? Everything she swallows, every drop of spit her mouth makes is gonna go right into her lungs, into her main stem bronchi. So she can't eat. She can't really even have any spit pool in her mouth because it's going to go in there. But where would you put a breathing tube to protect her airway? There's not really anywhere to put the breathing tube to protect her airway because we don't have a trachea to provide a border to stop it up because her trachea is wide open. So this creates a lot of problems in trying to figure out how to solve the problem for her. Because you don't even have a good way to have anesthesia if you can't ventilate, you can't oxygenate, and you can't provide anesthetic gases, much less how you're going to get to it surgically repairing it. So she had an abnormal trachea, without a doubt. She had a very, very large tracheal defect. Overall, her trachea was short, slightly to her advantage, which permitted us to do all of our work just through her neck without having to open her chest to do surgery. She had left bronchomalacia, meaning a floppy, small bronchus. So her left main stem bronchus over there, that should be like the size of this one over here, but you can see it's really, really skinny over there. So the skinnier it is, of course, as you can imagine, the harder it is to get thick, sticky secretions out of it. Just like the size of your straw. It's harder to get good flow of anything through a coffee straw than it is through like one of those tapioca bubble straws, the big ones. So those were the problems with her bronchus, and all of this was potentially compromising her left lung because you can't get the secretions out of there easily. Meanwhile, on the right side, she had all that barium, which is really, really sticky. It's really hard to get it out. The body doesn't clear it very well, and that was potentially compromising much of the alveolar sac because it was this sticky powder substance coating her membranes for air, for oxygen diffusion. So we've already started hitting on the problems caused by this. So how do we keep her airway stable? How do we oxygenate and ventilate her if we're going to do surgery, because there's really nothing to intubate, and both lungs were compromised by the barium and by her anatomy. How are we going to give her anesthesia when we had volatile anesthetic gases that we needed to give her, but no way to get them in there safely to her without, of course, putting everyone else in the room to sleep, which sometimes happens. We had a very long surgery that we were expecting, because not only was she going to need her airway fixed, but she was also going to need surgery to address the esophagus and things like reflux, because if anything came out of her stomach and went up into her airway, it would also land into her lungs and, of course, compromise the suture lines during a repair. And then what tissue were we going to use to fix that? A third of her tracheal circumference was missing. A third of her esophageal circumference was missing. So that's a lot of tissue. And then what do we use for donor materials or grafted materials? We call them grafts when we place something not from the area into the area in order to fix things. And then keeping her tissue healthy was a big problem. Nutrition in and of itself is an issue. If you can't get nutrition from your intestines and you have to get it all provided through the IV, people tend to have more problems with immune dysfunction, and they don't heal wounds as well. So the immunosuppression affects wound healing, and then getting all of that nutrition into her was a task because we needed places to put it, IV places. Her poor muscular tone, because that whole trachea didn't have all of its muscle, it's missing its muscle. So, or her esophagus was missing its muscle on the front third. So how are we going to control things when we don't even have good muscular tone? We have a wide open esophagus and a stomach that wants to dump things up there. Not to mention all of the pooling saliva coming down from above, which has some enzymes in it. Salivary amylase is supposed to begin digestion of sugars in your mouth. And then your stomach has acid, and then you've also got peptide digestive enzymes in anything in your early intestines, as well as detergents made by the liver, the bile salts. And so all of those things are supposed to be destructive. They don't let germs through. They're not supposed to. And they're going to have to break down all of the stuff that you eat. And so all of that compromises wound healing. So we thought we had a solution for her. Our solution was that first we were going to do a surgery to repair her airway and to protect her from reflux from her stomach. And that when we were done, we would intubate her with a standard breathing tube and get her to the intensive care unit, where they would keep her calm for a week. And then we'd go back in a week and we would look at her airway and probably get a breathing tube out. We still hadn't quite solved the problem of how we were going to get her under anesthesia, since we didn't really have a good place to put a breathing tube. But we went with the rest of the plan, hoping that somehow we'd figure it out by the time we got there. We figured we would do a wrap of the stomach around the esophagus to reduce the reflux, and we'd put a feeding tube in far away from the stomach. We wouldn't even feed the stomach, we'd put it in her jejunum. And if we fed her jejunum, then it wouldn't get back up into her stomach, and food and digested stuff would stay far away. And then we'd fix the trachea through the neck using perichondrium, so the covering over, actually periosteum, from the right clavicle. So we like to steal things like periosteum, perichondrium, fascia, the connective tissues from wherever we can steal them, and then put them in other places in order to have to avoid borrowing from something outside of the body. And a lot of the time, these things work really, really well. And 6 months before her, 6 months before Maddie, I had actually used a right clavicular periosteal graft for a very similar repair, and it went beautifully. So she had her surgery. It went way longer than we thought it might. She did her first 6 hours were just doing her Nissen wrap and putting her feeding tube in. And the day before, 2 days before the surgery, I came up with a solution to how we would intubate her. And I made a breathing tube out of three other tubes. So I took a big tube and I cut the end off, and I took two small tubes and cut the ends off of them. And I jammed the two small tubes into the big tube and I super glued it. But the super glue was not drying because it was inside the tube. well, it's crazy glue, Craggle. Crazy glue is really good. It wouldn't dry, so I put it in isopropyl alcohol and it cured the crazy glue and held everything in place. So we used a homemade breathing tube for her, and it turned out it actually worked and worked really well, and they were very, very happy with her during surgery, even though it was really long. So then the next 6 hours were where we worked through the open neck, but because we had to pull that tube out in order to have room to work, we had to keep ventilating only one lung for her. And the problem with ventilating only one lung is that you don't get enough of that carbon dioxide off. You can get plenty of oxygen in because you can always push up the concentration of the oxygen in the blood. It'll diffuse into the blood as well as be carried in the red blood cells. But you have to get the carbon dioxide out, and there just isn't enough surface area. So patients tend to get very acid in their blood when you're on one lung only. So when that happens, it's bad for the tissues. And it's not so good for brain. And so we really want to try to minimize doing that. So what happens is you work for a little while, and then you stop and you ventilate them. And then you work for a little while, and then you stop and you ventilate, which takes longer and longer and longer to get it done. But we got it done. And what I had done is gone through and made an incision the whole way down her trachea and her larynx and opened everything up and repaired the back. And then repaired the front and put in a new breathing tube, just a regular breathing tube in there for her. And we sent her back upstairs. So this is a picture of us working. And right here, this is a vocal cord right here. And then this is a vocal cord here. And this is open up here because we've cut the larynx in half right down the middle. It's called a laryngofissure when we split it that way. This is a little cotton pledget that we use just to help control some of the blood flow. And that's a wire-reinforced breathing tube that we would put in periodically. I had made the same double-barreled one so that we could ventilate her periodically. This is what it looked like over on the right at the end of the surgery. So she had her suture line there, and we had her all back together, and we took a look from above, and things looked really pretty nice. But the week that followed was a huge stress, really. Let's see, here we go. She had increasing needs for sedating medications, and the more she fought the ventilator, the more they gave her, but the harder time they had when she stopped breathing on her own, the harder time they had getting rid of carbon dioxide gas for her. So she started into this very vicious cycle where they would put more medicine, but then they would need to give her more pressure, and they gave her a lot of pressure, and this started making me very nervous. And then she started to have green bile secretions in her feeding tube drainage, and this made me even more nervous. And then even under anesthesia, she started vomiting bile. So the vomiting was green. It was bad. It was coming, green stuff was appearing in her mouth. Shouldn't have been there. Because she had a wrap around her stomach, of her stomach around her esophagus. She had a tube that was sitting in her stomach to let burp stuff out. And then she had the chamber that went out into her jejunum to feed her. And this should have been past three sphincters before it ever got up to her mouth. So it passed three fire doors and made it to her mouth. So that was very, very concerning. And then it was even more concerning when the secretions ended up in her breathing tube, because there shouldn't have been a connection between the two. So we went to the operating room at the end of the week, and when I pulled the breathing tube out to look at her airway, everything I had done was gone. The bile salts had eroded the whole graft. It was the very worst single moment I've ever experienced, because I did not know how I was going to get her fixed. I did not know how she would live through any of this at that point. So we had her without a breathing tube for that afternoon, but she got tired and we had to put a breathing tube back in for her. So we went back to the homemade tube because it had worked before, and now there was a wide open trachea again, so we put that one back in for her. And because of all of the stuff that was coming up that shouldn't have been coming up, her surgeon got worried, her general surgeon got worried there was something wrong in her belly. So she took her to the operating room and found that because of all of the energy that it would take for her to have healed everything we had done. She had areas of in her intestines where near the end of her feeding tube, it had been putting pressure on an intestine and had eroded right through. And so she had areas of dying tissue, and she had connections where she shouldn't have had connections. And so this bile that never should have been coming up had found a bypass route to turn back around and end up in the stomach where it never should have been. And so 8 hours worth of work disconnecting the biology's abnormal connections and closing up holes, removing dying tissue, making her Nissen even stronger and longer, and changing her feeding tubes around. She got through that, but it was definitely not without its disappointments. So we knew that we'd got her through all of the abdominal stuff, and she was doing better every day, but we couldn't immediately fix the airway again because it was a freshly operated field. And freshly operated fields are terrible places to put stitches. They don't like to hold. It's just like, any other wound that if you don't leave the scab on it long enough to let it heal, it's gonna heal ugly, and it could take a long time to heal. And if you have stitches in something that is wet, like this is why they tell you don't take your stitches swimming, they'll tear right through the tissues. And so these are not places that we want to put tissues. It's actively remodeling, and the stitches will rip right through. So we needed to give her some time. Time gave us two things. It gave us growth and weight and nutrition. And then it also gave us time away from the last repair where the tissues would firm up a little bit so that we could put stitches in again and hopefully they would hold. But I needed a new approach because I did not like the periosteum I had used. Her clavicle was so tiny. It was such a small piece of tissue. And I've always worried that by having stolen almost all of the covering of her right clavicle, that clavicle may not even grow. And so if I did that on the other side, I would definitely be making a very funny looking baby if she kept the same size clavicles for like her entire life. So I didn't necessarily want to steal that tissue a second time. So we've thought about what we could do for her third surgery, which was going to be her second airway repair. And we figured, well, we've been living off of this homemade tube, which we call the Pope tube. We'd been living off of it for about 8 weeks. So we could probably make it for a little bit longer, get started into another major surgery. But we wouldn't be able to operate around it. It was too big. There's no way to fix the airway with that. So this wasn't going to be a good solution for her in the operating room. And maybe possibly all of the time when she was acidotic, working off of only one lung, maybe that had been a contributor to why her tissues broke down so easily. So this time we decided to use something called ECMO. And it would take time to get her onto ECMO. So we would need the Pope tube to get to ECMO. Then we would use ECMO to just oxygenate her blood without using her lungs for a week. And then during that time, we would have a regular tube in there just in case we needed to rescue her airway. For surgery, I would go through the neck again, but instead of going through it vertically, this time I preferred to be able to reach further down and make sure that I could get all the way down to the carina where the branching happens and be really secure that I was happy with my stitches down there. So this time my plan was to take the trachea off of the larynx and pull the whole thing forward and then repair the esophagus behind and repair the trachea and lay it back in. This time I would use four layers, native layer of esophagus, and I would use a graft and then use another graft on the outside of the trachea and then the tracheal suture line. Because I felt like if I had four layers, if one broke down, there would always be somebody backing them up if I had four layers. And this time I was going to use a different material. I decided to use extracellular matrix. So now we have some new vocabulary. We have ECMO and we have extracellular matrix. ECMO is extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. It's an amazing feat, quite honestly. It allows for the lung function to be completely bypassed. This is actually, this is our standard board exam question is, if a child is buried in the sand, how do you save their life? Because the sand fills the lungs, and then the lungs can't exchange gas. You have to go on ECMO until you can clean them out. So blood leaves through the jugular vein, and it comes in through the carotid, so you can imagine that those are some pretty important vessels involved. The bigger the vessel and the more important it is, the riskier the whole thing gets. Because if you can't get on it through the jugular and the carotid, you have to go at it through an open chest, and you basically take the blood out of the heart from the chest and pour it back in to the heart from the chest. So that one is really not desirable. So we had to, the surgeons put her on ECMO by putting a large cannula in her jugular vein that actually had a tip that reached all the way down into the left atrium. And blood would come out and it would go through the box, and then it would go to the oxygenating membrane over here. And this membrane allows the gases from your mixture to diffuse across to your blood sample, which the pump for all this is full of donated blood, because there's no way a baby has enough blood to be in their body and in a machine that's four times their size at the same time. And then it gets warmed back up, and then it gets delivered back through the carotid artery with a tip right down in the top of the aorta, the aortic arch. So it sounds kind of simple here, I guess, but it doesn't look simple once you start to see all the equipment involved. And it means that there has to be a perfusionist, a specialist, who is balancing their blood gases constantly and watching the pumps to make sure that all the pumps are turning and that nothing is shutting off 24/7, which is a big deal. So ECMO has a lot of risk with it. One is that you have to put all this donated blood in. So donated blood always worries people for antibody formation. People react to donated blood, and also for infection if it's contaminated. Not only that, but just putting the blood in and the connections themselves can have bacterial contaminants on them. So it's always a scary system. You do your best to keep it sterile, like a completely closed system, so nothing can get into it that could make the patient sick. The tubing running throughout the system and the membrane itself have these microscopic imperfections that become sites for turbulence. When there's turbulence, there's areas where blood pools, it stagnates, and when blood doesn't move, it tends to clot. And so the tubing can get clots through it. They have to keep cutting out segments of tubing and putting new tubing in there. But if the clot dislodges, clot can go back into the patient, and then they can have stroke. So your answer, how you deal with that, is by giving them blood thinners so that they don't stroke. But they can bleed. So you can go from an ischemic stroke, where there's no oxygen going into the tissue in the brain, to where you have a hemorrhagic stroke, where you have a ton of blood in a space that shouldn't have blood. And that can be very bad, too. And they bleed from the sites in the neck where it goes in, and they bleed from their IV sites, and they bleed from their surgical incision, and they bleed the entire time you're operating. So it's much more challenging surgically. And then finally, the chemicals that the plastic tubing is made out of have been associated with a condition called pump head in cardiac bypass surgery, where people, when they come out of cardiac bypass, tend to have problems with memory, and sometimes even their affect or their personality for several weeks to sometimes months after the surgery. And some of it is embolically associated with the plastics that are part of the tubing. So the other word was extracellular matrix, which is sort of that structural layer in between the cells. And it has a lot of cool things in it that help the cells know what's going on. There's growth factors. There's a lot of extracellular signaling. There's the fibronectins. There's collagens, which are part of scar and wound healing. There's elastins, which give tissue elasticity. And it is a substance that can be native from the patient. You can borrow their own. It can be cadaveric or donated, coming from another place. This extracellular matrix that I decided to use was from pig intestines. Pigs have been very kind to humans for a long time, even though they had that whole trichinosis problem with eating them for a long time. Pig valves have been used to replace human heart valves for almost 50 years. And so they tend to have a lot less reactivity, and human bodies can tolerate the proteins on their system much better than they can almost any other animal. So the pig intestine has these layers. There's mucosa on the surface, there's submucosa. Here's a little better picture. There's all the little GI intestinal cells up there. And then you've got your lamina propria layer. So this has got connective tissue in it and extracellular matrix, and this is extracellular matrix. And so there's these layers that can be really, really useful. So the stuff that I used was basically those extracellular layers. So there's the cell walls right there with that space in between. And the stuff that I used was commercially available. It was derived from the pig intestine by decellularizing it. So through the process of cytolysis, where you put it the tissue in a very, very hypotonic solution, so basically like a distilled water, and those cells are all full of ions, and they're full of proteins, they're full of all these things that make the cell start absorbing water through osmosis. The water comes in, but eventually the cell membrane becomes too unstable to handle the volume inside, and then the cells rupture. So I have here, these are some cells that were in a hypotonic solution, and that's the cells exploding. So when the cells explode, the proteins that are there are all really helpful because they're part of intracellular signaling, but they're no longer viable cells. They're not alive. They can't share active replication of DNA. These cells are dead. They're not coming back. So this tissue has this beautifully, nicely, osmotically decellularized tissue to it, as opposed to having something that has essentially poisons in it, like formaldehyde, formalin, glutaraldehyde, things that are normally used to fix tissue and to destroy the cells and inactivate it. Because those things can be very, very destructive if you're trying to put them in something that you want to heal, because they're the things that they've used to preserve dead tissue for like eternity in the pathology lab. We don't want it preserved for eternity. We want it functional. We want it living and viable. So this is a picture of the commercially available extracellular matrix. It comes in much bigger volumes than a teeny tiny baby's clavicle could offer. You put it in a little bit of saline, and very quickly it hydrates, and it turns into something that's really nice to work with, to sew to. And it's not just one layer or two layers. It's 14 or 15 different layers of intestinal ECM that are stacked together and dried. And then if you leave them sitting in water or saline long enough, they'll actually float apart in layers. But if you hydrate it quickly, put it in the body, and sew it in place, then you have something that really holds your stitch, is really durable. And they've used it in heart surgery, and they found that cardiac myocytes will grow right onto the surface, and eventually that will even disappear on pathologic specimen. So it beautifully incorporates into the tissue, which means that the tissue around it will grow. It'll be more normal tissue, and then it will grow with the baby. So to me, this became a very irresistible option, given my circumstances. This is just a little bit about the different types of grafts. We've used all kinds of things over the years, and I was very reticent to use something that was a foreign body for this baby, because whatever I do to her, I commit to her to for the rest of her life. And many years ago when I was in training, we were using dermal grafts to replace tissues we had taken out. They were cadaveric. They'd been preserved, and there's probably no way there was anything that was infectious that was going to survive the process. But after using it for 3 or 4 years, the company confessed that they had never screened any of the donors for communicable diseases. And to me, that is a dishonesty in the derivation of the tissue that makes it concerning altogether. How do we know how safe anything that that company had given us really was? I mean, we all would like to know that the that if you didn't ask the questions about hepatitis and HIV, that you at least tested the tissue, but they didn't test the tissue. And so with that type of an experience, I didn't want to put anything in her that I thought could be like that. I didn't want to create extra concerns for her family. So as I mentioned before, some of the old preservatives are really toxic to the tissues. The proteins are denatured. There aren't the existing pro-growth factors in them. And as I said, the donors weren't well screened. So this was an animal donor that's been traditionally kind to humans, and it was osmotically prepared so that the cells were dead and gone, but there was still intracellular signaling material there. And pigs, by the way, are a very, very fragile population. Even though they look like they're all playing in the mud when you're looking at them on the farm, most pig farmers who grow large groups of pigs for like sausage and such, they can't even allow people onto the property wearing shoes that have been worn off of the property, because you can bring in communicable disease and you can wipe out the entire farm. So pigs tend to be treated in a lot of isolation. So it really reduces the amount of infectious disease they could possibly be bearing, because their populations can be so fragile. So the first surgery I had used for perichondrium, it's a homograft. It's the same human and from, it's autologous, it came from her. But now I was going to use the allograft because I could get an awful lot more tissue out of it. It was much more satisfying to work with, and it was easily replaceable. If I dropped it on the floor, I didn't have to have a panic. I could open another package. So this is her body in surgery when we did the repair. And I know it just looks like a bunch of like bloody steak or something, but this is a suture that's holding the trachea forward. And then this is the edge of the trachea here. This is the tissue that was sewn together to create the closure of the tracheal wall. This is the graft material. So I'd already closed the esophagus and then put this big piece of that graft material in there. And then I put another piece on the back side of the trachea. And then this got laid back down in here and sewed back to her voice box. Although the surgery lasted all day, because it took an hour to get her downstairs and get the room set up, and then it took 4 hours to get her onto ECMO, which it doesn't usually take quite so long, but she had tiny vessels and it was horrible. And then it took 4 hours to do her repair, and then it took an hour to get everything settled back up, get her moved to the bed, and then transport everything back to the room. Every day we had a new challenge with her, because this isn't something that any hospital does with any type of routine, because the anomaly is so rare. So this is essentially that repaired trachea inside at surgery. This was the next week. She's up in this little bed here. She's a tiny little nubbin right there. And then these are all medications that are pumping for her. She's getting nutrition, she's getting sedation, she's getting pain medicine. She had tons of medicine. She had enough medication that she was getting at the end that you basically could put a horse to sleep with what she was getting for her tiny little body. Then this is all separate over here. This is the ECMO. So these are all the parts of the ECMO machine over here. And then more stuff, because they can add medicines and stuff over there, and they run the anticoagulant from over there. This is Maddie and asleep during that week. So this is the J tube. That's the one in her intestines. And this is her G tube. That's the one in her stomach, letting everything out of her stomach. We just didn't want anything pooling anywhere. She had a chest tube, because with her ECMO insertion in her neck, her lung had dropped. This is urine coming out here. And then we had a breathing tube just sort of sitting in there in case we needed to rescue her, and that we would use at the end to get her lungs back open to bring her back. And then here are the tubes with all the blood. The bright red on the top is the blood, the oxygenated blood coming back in. This is every time we had to take her down to the operating room. That's moving all of her equipment. The perfusionist over here. It's just 5-6 people to push all of her stuff up and down the stairs and hope we don't accidentally rip anything out of her neck along the way. And this is what her airway looked 2 months after surgery. She had a tiny little pouch. It happens a lot with the TE fistula patients. But this is her left main stem and her right main stem there. And this is a view a little bit further. Over here is a little bit further up her airway. And this is just the back of her voice box, her larynx right there. And then that's the view of her airway at 3 months after surgery. So this is before on the left and after on the right. So we finally had two separated tubes. It wasn't exactly the end of the story because it was really hard to get her to breathe on her own stably with the amount of medication she was getting. It was a tremendous amount of medication, and those medications have lots and lots of side effects. And so we got her home 3 days before Christmas, and she came back in the hospital one time over the next year for a cold. She had a trach, so she had a little tube in her trachea from the front that helped ventilate her for the first portion of her time at home. But these are recent pictures of her. She opened her presents for Christmas this year. She steals her brother's toys. She wants to know what her friend finds so fascinating with this sippy cup, because she gets all of her nutrition through her feeding tube still. She does a lot of giggling and laughing, and I wanted to have a good video for you, but I didn't really have a good one for you. And her mom said, when I talked to her at Christmas this past year, I said, I still look back on her and think that I could have got her home without the trach. I had gone away on a surgical trip, and I told them there is this single day is where she will make it or she will not. And I felt like it was preventable to keep her stable and flying. But while I was away, after having taken care of her every single day over 4.5 months, nobody listened. And so she kind of decompensated. And I look back at that day and I kick myself for being gone that week. And I told her, Mom, you know, I still look back on those days. I have the picture of her the day before I left. And that's where she should have been. And that she should have been able to sail from there. And her mom said, it doesn't matter, because probably we think she would have ended up with the trach anyway, and that's okay, because she's home and she's with us, and it's our greatest joy to have our daughter home with us. And so even though I hate that portion of the pathway, they're happy and thankful, and she looks really good, and she is continuing to amaze all of her therapists and all of her other doctors. So I have to thank Maddie every day for being a trooper every day of her life. And her parents, Megan and Matt, they helped me with the photo collection, but they also have been the most amazing supportive family. They would like to never, ever, ever, ever have to think about ECMO ever again. They said that was the worst part of the whole experience, seeing their baby with all that blood pouring out and coming back in, and the fragility. There was one moment when the power went out, and fortunately, the whole system has backups built in it, but when you hear everything else in the intensive care unit stop, and your kid is on a machine like that, it's like that moment is the, oh, I'm going to die because I can't handle this. And they said that they would love to never have to remember that ever again. So even getting them to give me the ECMO pictures was a little bit of a challenge, because they have them, but they don't like to look at them. It was my friend, Dr. Khan, who's a heart surgeon, who suggested that I try the material. He'd used it for years doing things with heart repair, even taking out dead muscle and sewing this stuff in, and things grew back and worked well. But it wasn't something that we've done in otolaryngology. It wasn't something that any of our pediatric surgeons had ever done. Not my colleague. Pretty much no one I know had used it. In fact, there's one report where they used it to repair an adult trachea in a patient who had an area that was too tight and that they had fixed with it. Kimberly Mulligan is the rep from the company who had given me supporting materials, and she very patiently answered every question I asked her while I grilled her about the possibility of there being safety issues with the material. And then finally, I think Cole, who was the patient who I repaired 6 months before her, who gave me the opportunity to practice all of the techniques needed, but also Rabbit 322, who was a rabbit being sacrificed, who loaned me his trachea to practice on when I was getting ready for Cole's surgery. And thank you to you guys for staying awake. I know I've run out of my time. And to GT, who brought me here to share Maddie's story.